Imagine writing software so powerful that the government of the United States declared it a weapon, like a tank or a bomb. During the Cold War, the US and its allies developed export controls with the aim of stopping Western technology from falling into the hands of the USSR and other socialist states. How do we arrive at a point where the ability to secure sensitive communications, a technology based on the principles of mathematics, could be viewed by governments as an essential tool and a dangerous weapon? For most of history, encryption was primarily used by governments, militaries, and spies to transmit secret messages. The 20th century was where cryptography became an essential part of military communications. During World War II, the Nazis utilized the Enigma cipher to protect their diplomatic and military communications. This was successfully cracked by the Allies and allowed them to extract information from German radio broadcasts. This highlighted the importance of using secure cryptography. This was only the start of cryptography's large role in military and diplomatic conflicts. The battle for secure, sophisticated cryptography systems only intensified as two of the world's superpowers clashed, the Soviet Union and the United States of America. Both heavily invested in developing their own cryptographic algorithms and also breaking each other's cryptographic codes. During the start of the Cold War, the United States established a secretive signal intelligence agency called the National Security Agency, or the NSA, recognizing the critical importance of signals intelligence at the time. The fierce competition during the Cold War between the United States and the Soviet Union spurred the enactment of the International Traffic in Arms Regulations. This enactment was aimed at regulating the control of military exports, with the aim of stopping advanced technology from falling into the hands of the Soviet Union. The ITAR regulations specifically determined what defense and military technology could be shared outside of the United States. Sharing these specific technologies and information without prior authorization by the US government could lead to large fines or even imprisonment. The US government maintained a comprehensive list of technology and information, known as the United States Munitions List. ITAR classified strong encryption algorithms as arms and included them on the munitions list, making it illegal to share such technology with individuals outside the United States. A new character enters the story, Phil Zimmermann, an American computer scientist and cryptographer. He was very politically active and participated in the anti-nuke movement during its heyday in the 1980s. Through his political work, he realized that activists needed privacy protection and a way to communicate that couldn't be intercepted by the United States government.
And I figured back then that there was a need to protect grassroots political organizations from the government and other governments around the world, other countries around the world, and oppressive countries, that human rights groups, human rights workers, or just ordinary people that wanted to protect and needed to protect their human rights, needed to have this kind of tool.
Through the 80s, Zimmermann kept this thought lingering, but his work commitments and activism prevented him from pursuing it. It wasn't until January of 1991 when Senator Joe Biden, yes, that Joe Biden, co-sponsored a bill called the Comprehensive Counterterrorism Act. Zimmermann realized that the foundational right to privacy was being stripped away, as the law required all encryption schemes to include a backdoor, which would allow government agencies to surveil all encrypted communications. Zimmermann decided now was the time to fight back. And now that he had more time to work on developing software, he spent 6 grueling months creating his magnum opus, Pretty Good Privacy, or PGP.
Engineers are such pathological optimists when it comes to estimating time required to finish something, and I was no different. So I didn't realize it was going to take so long, and I missed 5 mortgage payments writing it.
PGP used keys that were no smaller than 128 bits, Anything using over 40 bits was classified by the United States government as high-strength encryption, which was restricted from being exported outside the United States. Towards the end of 1991, Zimmermann created the first release of PGP. He shared the program with a friend who published the program on Usenet, a popular distributed discussion system that was used internationally at the time. Zimmermann was aware of the export restrictions on cryptography, so he made an honest attempt to stop its spread outside of the US. He asked his friend to tag the post as US only. Zimmermann stated at the time, "I did not know enough about Usenet newsgroups to realize that a US-only tag was merely an advisory tag and had little effect on how Usenet propagated newsgroup listings." Despite Zimmermann's attempt to stop the spread outside the United States, the distributed system of Usenet propagated his software around the globe and therefore placed PGP into the hands of every individual. At first, it seemed like Zimmermann had escaped the clutches of the United States government. As the program started circulating around the globe, it was still rather niche, as the primary users of the software were cyber activists. In 1993, Zimmermann was contacted by customs agents regarding his encryption program. They stated they simply wanted to discuss his program and denied that Zimmermann was the target of any investigation. When Zimmermann realized they were located in San Jose and planned to fly to his home in Boulder, Colorado, this immediately raised his suspicion that there was more to their intentions than just seeking advice. Sensing this, Zimmermann hired a criminal lawyer called Phil Dubois. It turned out that Zimmermann's instincts were correct. The agents were conducting a criminal investigation into Zimmermann. This investigation would go on for 3 years as the government attempted to determine whether Zimmermann had violated the Arms Export Control Act, a crime which could carry quite a hefty sentence, ranging from 41 to 51 months if he was prosecuted and found guilty. Phil Dubois, Zimmermann's lawyer, stated the case was pivotal at the time. Zimmermann's case was quickly picked up by news outlets due to the mainstream popularity and support for Zimmermann. He received a large amount of donations to his legal fund, and some of these donations were cheekily encrypted using PGP. While Zimmermann's lawyers were battling things out in court, another case arose that would also challenge the US government's international traffic in arms regulations. A graduate student at the University of California, Berkeley, named Daniel J. Bernstein, had developed an encryption algorithm which he called Snuffle. In the interest of scientific endeavors, he wished to publish the algorithm itself and a mathematical paper describing the algorithm along with the source code of a computer program incorporating it. The export laws required Bernstein to obtain a government license to publish his ideas. If he shared or published his algorithm without it, he would face significant legal repercussions. Bernstein believed this violated his First Amendment rights and that his algorithm should be protected as a form of expression. Eventually, in 1995, there was a landmark decision in Bernstein's case that declared software code as a form of speech. This meant that it was protected under the First Amendment. A year later, in 1996, the US government dropped their case against Zimmermann.
The FBI, the NSA, the press, everybody participated in this debate, and there was a lot of expert participation from all these quarters, a lot of legal scholars. Everybody was involved, and it took years, and we came to a decision collectively that we should get rid of the export controls, that we should not have domestic controls, and I think it was a good decision.
Zimmermann's PGP was later converted into a standard known as OpenPGP, which is still used to this day to protect people's email communications. The ability to use strong encryption wasn't a given. It has been continually fought for throughout history. It may seem like the fight for encryption has largely been won, but the attempts to stifle secure encryption didn't stop after the Cold War. If you enjoyed this video, get subscribed. In our next video in this series, we'll explain how the NSA targeted strong encryption as modern communications became more prevalent among the general public. See you next time on Privacy Guides.